Black people, we've got a problem. We've got a pandemic that we're not even aware of, and it is obesity. The thing is, if you're thinking about how you can get in amazing shape, how you can lose weight, how you can lose body fat, it's mainly down to a few factors. And it's scary, the amount of issues that we face as a community when it comes to our weight loss. And actually, I'm walking on my treadmill. You might be able to hear it in the background, but there's so many statistics here when it comes to weight loss, it's actually scary. So let's quickly talk about it before I get into what we can do to make things better. So here's a statistic for you that is pretty scary. 75% of Black adults in England are classified as overweight or living with obesity, compared to the general population at only 64%. We are 10% higher when it comes to obesity, which is obviously a problem. Now, we're talking about kids, and we know the kids are the next generation. Childhood obesity, Black children, particularly those from African and Caribbean backgrounds like myself, show higher rates of obesity compared to all the other ethnic groups. That is a problem. They consistently have higher BMI scores from early childhood. Now, I'm going to get into some of the factors in a second, but that's a little bit scary because, you know, I want to make sure that our Black babies are well looked after. All babies, but obviously my people. Physical inactivity is more prevalent among Black adults, with only 55% being physically active compared to higher rates in white, British and mixed ethnic groups. Okay, obviously another important factor. Dietary habits and cultural food preferences can influence obesity rates. And traditionally, African and Caribbean diets have higher calorie foods that contribute to weight gain. I'm going to get into this in a second because there's an important factor as to why that's actually important. And last but not least, obesity rates are higher amongst Black women compared to Black men. I think we know that, generally speaking, obesity rates are higher in women anyway. That's kind of normal, I guess. And let's get into why this is important. First things first, we know that Black men, they suffer from obesity, diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, very common in our communities. And these are things that we can actually change, we can fix, we can improve with the right kind of education. But there's something here in the research that I'm looking at that we need to look at. And it's basically the socioeconomical factors. Those socioeconomical factors we have to really bear in mind are basically income and being in deprived neighborhoods. Now, we know that Black Caribbeans specifically are lowest when it comes to home ownership, right? So they don't even have the money to buy houses. We are the lowest. On top of that, so Black Africans own more homes than Black Caribbeans. I want you guys to bear that in mind. On top of that, our diets. So we've got the socioeconomic factors, right? They can't afford to maybe have the higher gym memberships. They can't afford to maybe shop and get the best foods, which although we know that that doesn't necessarily mean that you can't lose weight or be unhealthy, but I think that there's a lot of different pressures that the Black families have to face. There's a lot of exclusion. You've ever been to a CrossFit class? Yeah, you might see one Black guy, one Black woman, maybe. Yeah, you might see one Black guy, maybe, if you're lucky. But the truth is, it's not very common. Like, it's not a common thing. So with that being said, we've got to start creating environments where Black people can actually improve their health and fitness. They can do things in the gym. They know what to do and they get the education. But because of the socioeconomic factors, we end up being in more deprived areas, which then means that we go to poorer schools, which then means that we're less likely to do things like PE. And if you look at the statistics of Black kids in PE, you can see an issue. If you look back to my previous video, where I spoke about fatherless homes, we know that if a child grows up in a home without a father, he's more likely to be expelled from school. He's more likely to end up in prison. He's more likely to end up in a lower income household. He's more likely to end up in poverty. That person is less likely to be educated on health, fitness, nutrition. So you can see that there's a lot of barriers for Black people to actually enter fitness, whether it's can't afford a gym membership, don't have the time because you have to work ridiculous hours just to get through to provide for their kids. Then also we've got the issue of like fatherless homes, which affects the Black community at higher proportions. So there's so many issues like coinciding, and all of these factors result in things like 75% of Black adults in England are classified as overweight or living with obesity, compared to only 64% for all the other races. That's a big problem. So this video is just to highlight that, and what we can do to change that is, well, I don't have the answer to that, to be honest. That's a broad answer. I wish I had the answers to that, but the only way you can change something like that is essentially education, man. We've got to educate from really young. We've got to educate in the household. We've really got to start thinking about what's going on with our traditional meals and food. How can we have those meals in healthier ways? Because I'm a Black Jamaican man. We have things like dumpling, yam, plantain, and yes, they can be very oily. But here's the thing, and I'll end it here. A lot of these dishes, especially for the Caribbean side, is actually come from slaves. And we basically used to eat meals that were easier to cook, quicker to cook, very carb heavy because it was cheaper. And that came from slavery. A lot of people don't know this, but that came from Caribbean slavery, a lot of these meals. So it was just because that's what they could afford and that was the quicker meals to eat. And then it became tradition and now it's been carried on for years and years and years. But we know now there's healthier ways to eat those meals. So we have to start looking into that. A bit of a different video today, a bit deeper, but I'm still going strong. I think I'm on 15 videos in the last 16 days. So the challenge is on. I'm actually looking forward to the challenge ending because it's been very difficult. But on the last day, I'll do a video talking about how posting 30 videos in a month has affected my YouTube account. If you have been watching these videos as I go on this YouTube sprint, thank you. If you haven't, then F you.